much for coming to candle lighting. As Mr. Meredith said, this roast is gentle. Kind of. But before you feel sorry for any of these kids sitting up here, I need to let you know that at the beginning of the year, they were warned to behave so we wouldn't have any fuel to fire these roasts. And none of them, not one of them, behaved. So tonight, they're just kind of getting what they deserve. So juniors in the back there, pay attention, because next year, anything you do can and will be held against you in this evening. With that said, seniors, this really is a celebration of you. It is. So let's have the beatings begin with John Brancato. John was trying to make money during study hall. I had no idea he was quietly turning my class into his own business. Why hadn't I thought of that? When I first heard about it, I assumed he was trying to run a Ponzi scheme, given how John can hear about new things and become a little obsessed with them. But no, alas, it was not a Ponzi scheme. It was, in fact, a social networking business of sorts, which he clarified for me by saying, "People just pay me to love them." He had a printed menu, $1 for a hug or a simple love note written from him to you. I'm glad he didn't offer any higher price services. Maddie Watt. Shh, I was trying to keep it on the DL. Maddie Moss lost many dollars paying him to write adoringly to her. "John, had you just told me about this, I would have hired you. There were many days when it would have been worth the money just to have someone write a nice something to me." Over the years, John has had an interesting series of obsessions. First, there was the Titanic, then World War II, then stand-up comedy, then Andy Warhol, and now art in general. He's eclectic. John's quirks and idiosyncrasies are but a sliver of the magnificent personality that shows up every day to school and doodles on every handout and test you give him. I'm keeping them, I know they're gonna be worth something. He's funny and quirky and smart and deliciously wry. He's taught me a lot about art, artists, and the art of being human. We applaud your activism and your talent. You wow all you meet. He shows up at rallies and art museums, offers his services, and winds up wildly beloved. CalArts is getting a gem, and our cyberarian will be missing a loyal visitor. Good luck next year. Years ago, Alexander had a backpack that was a bigger disaster than any Miss Beelman had ever seen. And that is saying something. Miss Beelman has been here a long time and has seen many manner of backpacks, and Beezy's was the worst of all time. Worse than Josh Sackheim's. From her backpack, a live creature emerged. Beezy has changed so much since her days of growing things in her backpack, but there is still something ineffable about her. Something so intriguing about her that it inspires fear. The truth is, Alex Beezy scares the crap out of all of us. She really does. She's brilliant, pleasant, warm, sprightly, joyous, courteous, shockingly original, and a teenage girl. Come on, how is this possible? Who took this woman's ego and ran away with it? Perhaps it is one of the zombies with whom she is obsessed. Okay, so the zombie obsession is another scary thing about Beezy. Alexander's been researching zombies for her year-long research paper in English. Who would have thunk it? Beezy once admitted on WNN that she could live for 2 months on nothing but lemons. Now truly, that's not human. Do zombies live for long periods of time on lemons? Who can be sure? But something strange and probably dangerous is alive in Alexandra Beezy. Well, she does her homework all the time, which is a sure sign of demonic possession around here. It isn't so much that Beezy is a demon, really. She's more the living representation of a fairy tale character. She's mythic. One of her friends said of her, "You should never really just leave Beezy on the street alone." That's apt advice. She's otherworldly, possesses powers and information not of this realm, and so she deserves protection while she's here. Thank you, Princess Beezy, for your uplifting spirit, your brilliant mind, your generous attitude, your happy ways. At the senior dinner, Alex came up to us and said, "I'm so glad there was dessert. I get really disappointed when there's not dessert." We do too, Beezy. And you've been the icing on the cake all year. What a sweet treat you are indeed. Good luck at Pierce next year. They are so lucky to get you.
Aaron Domio. Oh, now you want me to keep it down. All week he's been begging me to make it as cruel as possible, so that's what I did. I'm sorry. Okay. Aaron has a secret man friend named Steve. I've never met him, but I've heard stories. I think Steve showed up to football practice one day not wearing his underwear and scared everybody. Steve must be a trifle bit forgetful. Well, Aaron, we all need a little help from our friends, even if they are weird or imaginary. Aaron once asked me where was the smallest place I'd ever lived. "Why do you want to know that?" I asked. "Because you're going to have to live under my bed when I go to college, and I want to be sure you'll be comfortable there," he said in earnest. I'm a little hesitant about this arrangement, to say the least, but Aaron keeps insisting that I have to think of this relationship in the long term. I'm unclear how living under his bed and doing his college work is going to have long-term benefits for me, but he says I have to trust him. Okay. Aaron has few qualms about saying it like it is. If I announce that there will be a quiz the next day, Aaron blurts out, "Why would you do that? There is no need for that." The other day in class, he came up to me and in quiet, deliberate language said, "Now stay very calm. Very calm when I tell you this, but I can't find my outline for my paper. It's just gone." I find it incredibly humorous that he's more worried that I'll be upset over this than he will be that his outline is gone. Shouldn't I be the one telling him to stay calm? Shouldn't he be upset over the loss of his outline? But then again, shouldn't Aaron come to class every day wearing a shirt? Aaron continually admonishes me to relax. He says it's like falling down a mountain, which this job resembles on a daily basis. "If you tense up," Aaron says, "you'll just get more hurt." "You have to relax into it," he says. "Okay, so maybe I do need to relax a little, but Aaron, you could do the opposite every once in a while. Coming to school fully dressed so your hickeys are covered from view, and not eating a gallon of ice cream during class isn't asking too much, it really isn't. Despite a few glitches, you are a fabulous human being and a wonderful student. You've grown so much over the years here at Westmark, and we are all so proud of you. You've taught us so much about seeing what's important, about managing the world, about knowing when not to sweat the small stuff. Miss Zaragoza is not going to be able to function once her baby leaves, and I mean you and not her cat. Good luck at College of the Canyons. You'll see, you won't need me there, but I will come and watch you play football."
Brandon, Brandon, Brandon. Brandon wears a smile plastered on his face, his heart glued to his sleeve, and other things lodged in his shoes. You know, like arch supports. Brandon needs all the support he can get, and he receives it generously from all over the place because that devilish smile is too hard to resist. Brandon once remarked as he was reading a text message from his girlfriend that he finally found a good woman because her text reported that she had just folded and put away all his laundry. Miss Rhodey promptly vomited in the trash can, but knew Brandon's charm was just too much for this girlfriend to resist. That smile of his says it all and possesses superpowers that suck us all right in. Even his best friends can't resist his charms. Mindy and Maddie were struck with the sudden and unstoppable urge to see Brandon one night and drove all the way over to his house, scaled the walls, only to find he and his friends asleep on the couch in each other's arms. Okay, so sometimes Brandon disappoints, but most of the time he surprises. He's exceptionally perceptive, warm, bright, and genuine. He's worked hard this year to improve in all academic areas, and his teachers are very proud of him. Any school glitches along the way probably happened because he was unfortunate enough to sit in the front row of Miss Rhodey's class. That particular location in the universe has an ominous and destructive relationship with time. All four of the students who sit there during first period, who henceforth shall be referred to as the front row four, are notoriously late to school and late with their homework. Brandon typifies this front row messed up time relationship. We are sure, however, that once he gets to college and away from this powerful vortex in the space-time continuum, he can hide in the back row and be punctual in all things school related. Thank you for your sensitivity, your care, and your attention this year. Good luck at the University of Arizona next year.
Mindy Feldman. Mindy Feldman hates me. She makes no bones about it. Her derision is reflected in her rolled eyes, frustrated sighs, and pronouncements such as, "I don't connect with Miss Rhodey." She spends most of her time texting in the back of my class, and I'm sure she's sending out mass messages that read, "I hate Miss Rhodey. Send this message to 12 people or bad luck will follow you." This disdain all comes as such a relief to me, quite frankly, because it has been so exhausting to be so beloved by so many for so long. For this relief and much more, I love Mindy Feldman. She's a take-charge self-advocate, a caring student, and a humanitarian. But such gifts are often balanced by fate's dastardly hand. One day, Mindy was just walking along and a bird pooped on her. "I'm so sorry, Mindy. I'm so sorry you suffered that overt punishment from the heavens. God probably knew how mean you were to me and sent that bird as payback." You know, the same thing happened to me when I was in the first grade. And so, Mindy, whether you like it or not, we're soul sisters. United in crap. The crap that just falls from the sky and ruins your day. But we're united in other ways too. We're little women who pack a punch. And now, admittedly, in a one-on-one brawl, you could take me. I'm a pacifist and I don't have fingernails and, well, I'm old. But would you really feel good about decking your middle-aged teacher? I think more than a bird would poop on you if you did that. In truth, I know you carry your power with gentility and affection. I know you are deeply sensitive and aware. You're loyal to your friends, and I know you learn your lessons like a rose. You take all the crap that life gives you and you grow beautiful gardens. You have not shied away from challenge. You have not shrunk from adversity. I think you're a fabulous woman. Sean Johnson, you are strong and competitive and a perfect 10. Wash off the bird poop and just keep tumbling along. Your future's solid gold.
Jake Garino. Jake is extremely intelligent. He really is. If you want to know about it, just ask him. He'll tell you. I'm just relieved he's not very good looking, because good looks and brains could really turn a young man into a narcissist, or worse, a crafty dictator who manages to subjugate every other animal in the barn. That would be scary. Jake is the second member of the front row four. In his defense, when he is late to first period, he usually has a worthy excuse, like having to pull over in order to win concert tickets from a radio contest. Smart Jake is known to say things like, "I don't have that assignment done today, but you know I could do it if I wanted to." Jake wants his grades to be based on understood potential. In his mind, a fascinating syllogism of sorts is at play. It goes something like this. If I did the work, you know I'd get an A, so what's the point of actually doing the work since I'm already capable of doing it? Not doing the work saves me time. Saves you time, it's a win-win situation. Yes, Jake, thank you so much for not doing all your work. It was truly a humanitarian act. Jake is capable of all kinds of humanitarianism. He'll offer to put his signature on a particularly good assignment in case you want to save it for posterity, or just feel blessed that he deemed you worthy of his autograph. He cuts school on occasion so there's one less body to worry about at school. He'll not bring his materials to class so as not to clutter up the place, or so you feel the benefits that come from that saying that it is better to give than to receive. Thus, you give him the book or the pencil, and oh yeah, we always feel so much better after that. We mock him here, but Jake really is brilliant, and I don't want to say too much to anger this young man, because he did promise us that he'd take us with him when he arrived at his full greatness. And man, are we looking for a one-way ticket to no work and all play. So please, Jake, remember us when you rule the world. If you could do it in the next 5 years, you'd save Miss Rhodey and me a trip to the asylum. But for now, you're pretty spectacular as is. Thanks for checking in on us every day. Your office visits made our day. And we know you just... Well, that makes no sense, Miss Rhodey.
Well, we know you weren't just there for the...
Oh, okay. There we go. She left out a couple words. We know your visits were purely humanitarian. Good luck in the Oxford summer program. Can't wait to hear your English accent when you return.
Jordan Haven. I love Jordan Haven very much. I have for years, ever since I taught him when he was in the eighth grade. But I'm gonna call him out on something right now, and you, young man, are just going to have to own and stew in it. Jordan tells horribly awful sexist jokes when adults are not present. Here's one. How many men does it take to open a beer? None. It should be open when it gets to him. Really, Jordan? Really? Oh, I know. It's just a silly, childish joke. You don't even know what a beer is. Here's one for you. What happens to seniors in high school when their female teachers learn they're chauvinists? Oh, they have to repeat the 12th grade until enlightenment catches on. Yeah, that's a good one. Despite Jordan's proclivity for sexism, he did manage to do the right thing when a prostitute knocked on his door in Canada asking for Steve. No joke. I am sure that his ultimate response came after some dizzying mental calculus. Okay, I could say I'm Steve. I really want to say I'm Steve. But I don't have money on me. I could ask my fellow classmates, but then they might want in on the action. How much time would I actually get? Finally, there's the fact that Miss Rhodey's hotel room is right next door to mine, and something tells me the that she would not be cool with this. Okay, I better just go with, there's no Steve here, and pray that this opportunity presents itself again when I'm in college and have a job. Nice work, Jordan. But I'm sure you still had her open your beer for you before she left. In truth, Jordan is a lot classier than I'm letting on. I mean, he carries a Coach bag, for gosh sakes. A man with a designer handbag and his own invented organization system can't be all bad. Just a little note here, Jordan. If you invent an organization system and it only works half the time, you might want to go with another system. But Jordan demonstrates his class in more powerful ways than just handbags. He's responsible, respectful, he's a leader on every playing field and in every classroom, and he's an enthusiastic learner. Jordan's decision to come back to Westmark was a gift to all of us, especially to Coach Fox, whose shirts Jordan wears in deference to him all the time. We hope you see your return to Westmark as a gift to yourself. We are so proud and so happy that you're going to be a Westmark alum. Good luck next year at Mesa State. Jordan said that was as bad as he thought it was going to be.
Sam Kornberg. Yeah, well, you know, we got to mix things up a little bit, keep you on your toes. Sam sits quietly at the back of class, but then he shaves his beard on the news. He falls asleep in class when the rest of the class is reading, but then he gets 100% on the reading quiz. He thinks he can't start an assignment unless he asks a billion questions first, but then produces a complete work of art. He placed into college-level English for next year, but boldly said, I don't think I want to do that. You'll be fine, Sam. Trust us. Sam often has to be dragged kicking and screaming into some work of brilliance, but he always gets to the brilliance, even when maintaining very strict boundaries for himself. He serves on student council, but often finds the pleasantries of social life unworkable. Here's a delightful representative example. The student council members were asked to serve as student ambassadors during a school function, and we're told that part of their job was to wear a smile all day. Is anyone not up for the task, they were asked. Sam's hand bravely shut up. Not me, I can't do it. Can't wear a smile on my face all day. That is simply asking too much. Good for you, Sam. To thine own self, be true. We don't know many teens who are that self-possessed or honest. Not many young people with the foresight to know that something along the way in any given day will more than likely wipe the smile right off your face. Heck, by second period, most of the senior teachers need more than a smile replacement. They need a drink. Bless you, Sam, for your quiet intelligence, your brave embrace of the day, and your kind nature. All these things are gifts. Good luck next year at college. You won't need it, but we offer you that anyway.
Julian Hernandez. Just like John Edwards said, there were two Americas. Hernandez's. That was not easy to say, but that is how you make your last name plural. Anyway, one Julian is quiet and works diligently. He's focused and turns in high-quality work that reflects deep thought and creativity. He's every teacher's dream. The other Julian, not so much. The other Julian talks all the time. I mean all the time. Like the timer has been set, and he's playing the who can say the most words in an hour game, and he's playing for the grand prize like he was last year's champion and he doesn't want to give up the crown. Nothing can stop this Julian from speaking. Not school, not other people talking, not a fire alarm. This Julian has trouble getting his work done or following directions or realizing exactly what day it is or even if he has to come to school. If only there were a pill that could help this Julian find the other Julian. But of course, I jest. Julian is a very kind and beautiful human being. He's gentle, even though he's a good football player. He's loving and respectful. He will thank you for little things and ask you genuinely how you are if you are out sick or having a bad day. He's perceptive and unique. He's also a great baker, so we know he can read well, follow directions, and do math all in one sitting when a sugary treat is involved. Perhaps most notably about Julian is the big turnaround he made from last year to this year. He was in school more days than he'd ever been before. And this was his senior year. Most people follow the opposite trend. Thank you, Julian, for just being who you are and for knowing that is really enough. It's a great gift to all of us. Good luck in all you do.
Rebecca Maddock. Rebecca, is your homing device going off? Did you need to wander over to Max and say howdy before we start? They're very good friends, and usually during the middle of class, Rebecca will get up to give him a hug when he arrives late, as if she's a homing pigeon and Max is her home location. Rebecca just loves to be standing up here. She loves it. No, really. Rebecca finds no greater joy than standing before a group of people and presenting. Actually, this is probably excruciating for her, and we love her for being here and giving it a go. Rebecca is the personification of Jerry Seinfeld's joke about public speaking, which goes, people's number one fear is public speaking. Their number two fear is death. Death is number two. So the average person at a funeral would rather be in the coffin than delivering the eulogy. But people's fears bring them together to great results. Remember when you were afraid of presenting the to be or not to be soliloquy to your English class? Nick came up and stood in front of you while you delivered it, so you could be shielded from your fear. While everyone probably loved Nick in that moment, you ended up getting to keep him. You gave him the opportunity to love you. You do that with your teachers when you're willing to ask for help, and you also give to others so they can shine, like when you stage managed a play. My guess is the cast of that play showered you with thanks because you gave fully of yourself to that experience. Despite your stage fright, you are a very good actress. We all saw your hilarious Cheeto-faced self in the Advanced Video 2 suspense film. Nice work. Never give up that tenacious spirit, that desire to give, and your desire to face your fears. We are all very proud of you. Now we're all going to be quiet and stare at you while you deliver the to be or not to be soliloquy. Okay, go ahead, just kidding. We want you to survive to give a eulogy someday. Good luck at Pierce next year.
That's Isaac. Alex thinks he can hide out in the back of class and not be noticed. He thinks if he's quiet, the teachers won't realize he isn't handing in his homework, as if silence makes you invisible. How'd that work out for you, Alex? I bet you didn't feel invisible when I was harassing you about homework assignments, or wouldn't let you go home when you wanted to skip study hall, or when I yelled at you for doing drugs in my classroom closet. I'm just kidding. I thought it would be funny to watch Alex start to have a heart attack as he wondered what his mom might think if I let that comment go with that explanation. That's the suffering you get for turning in late homework. So, okay, no, he didn't do drugs in the closet. He just got drunk in there. Oh, wait, no, that was me. Okay. Actually, a sober, hardworking, respectful student all year. He's shy and not much of a show-off, but this kid has a gift for literary analysis and creative writing. He really does. He also has a penchant for all things electrical. He tried to get the other kids in his class to cut the power lines at school in order to have some days off. I'm not kidding about that. Shockingly, Brandon offered to do it if someone would show him where they were. Also, whenever I couldn't get my overhead projector to work, all Alex had to do was stand near my desk and it would work, seriously. It made me think he was a being from an electromagnetically charged planet. You're a powerful kid, you really are. Good luck at Columbia next year. We know you'll do great.
Brian. Brian's been anticipating this for quite some time. I'm not sure if he's nervous, excited, or both. All of the above, he says. Brian Mandel is the most altruistic member of this entire class. He completely sacrificed himself as a student and as a human being so that all his teachers could go straight to the Club Med portion of heaven when they die. There is no question about this. Hermes the messenger god will greet us, take a look at our names and life's work, and immediately say, "My Zeus, you taught Brian Mandel?" Then a choir of angels will perform for us, and right after Hermes will continue, "Please, right this way. There's a chase lounge and a pitcher of margaritas waiting for you by the heated pool. You have your own cabana boy for all your needs. Enjoy!" Finally. And yes, we will take this gift with open arms because Brian was a species all his own in class. He threw books, walked out of class, swore, bugged other students, yelled, brought food to class, and gave us all manner of tics until we shot him with a tranquilizer gun. Oh, there I go, wishful thinking again. While it is true that in class, Brian was a Bengal tiger, outside of class, he was a baby kitten. He was respectful, loving, charming, and giving. He was also one of the most all-around talented athletes we have ever seen. He can jump, run, kick, catch, and tackle with powerful speed and dexterity. Brian is, without a doubt, at home on an athletic field, whether it's athletics or otherwise. Miss Zaragoza said he plays a mean game of Candyland, too. What Miss Zaragoza and Brian will do without each other next year is left to be seen. Miss Zaragoza, I think you'll probably get a lot of text messages. Brian hates to write English papers, but he sure loves to text. Brian, Miss Rhodey let you sneak some texts just so she could justify maybe passing you. That's at least some writing. That's what she figured.
That's what I figured too.
But you better do a little more English work just in case. We can't give you a diploma that says for success in math and running all over campus. Also, we can't give you a Mr. Congeniality award just because you leave your classes and visit every other class on campus. You may think you're being friendly to other Westmark teachers, but they don't see it that way. Mr. Carpenter is going to publish a book entitled My Angry Emails to the Westmark Admin Team About Brian Mandel, the 2009 communications. Brian, we know nothing is being said here that you don't already know. You are an extremely smart, capable kid, and in truth, your teachers really, really liked you. We think you know that because we could tell you liked us too. Next year, put all your enthusiasm and heart into the vocation of your choice. You'll be fine.
That was the longest he's ever been quiet in his whole life. Cliff Jones. You dropped your pocket. I have to be careful what I say tonight about Cliff Jones. If I lie about him, he threatened to shove me off the stage and break both my legs. I know. Not that I couldn't use the rest, but the pain part is a little daunting. Cliff is indeed a scary, powerful amalgam of parts. First off, he's huge, so I'm going to defer to that for a moment and apologize for anything I might have done at any point in the year to displease you. The edge of the stage is a little too close now that I'm standing up here. Cliff can dance, he can laugh, he can slay you with a biting comment, and he can tell a joke. I think he'd make a killing as a stand-up comedian or as a Coach Fox impersonator. Cliff is more than a giant athlete of a man. He's a teddy bear who can calm me down with the utterance of one, "Relax, sweetheart." Which usually comes when I'm having a meltdown because Brian Mandel just came barreling into class with a lion's roar in a tank top, a Jamba Juice, and no awareness at all that he is actually in school and I am actually in charge of the class. Relax, sweetheart. Indeed. More than anyone else in this class, Cliff Jones keeps me in check. He has no problem just laughing in my face if I'm being ridiculous. Without Cliff, I wouldn't know just how funny or crazy I really am. Inside this formidable tone deaf, I heard him try to sing at the senior dinner. It was awful. Physical presence, yeah, is one of the biggest hearts you have ever seen. Cliff loves and laughs and embraces life with courage and hilarity. His heart belies his "I could kill you if I wanted to" appearance. Cliff is the first student to notice when a class has been tough on a teacher. He stays behind to say thank you. He writes notes of gratitude and leaves them taped to our computer screens. He also leaves notes begging us to get him out of class and things like that, but that's a whole other story. Despite the fact that Cliff kept falling off the inner tube lifts on the snowy mountain in Canada at the winter park, which was one of the funniest things I have ever seen in my life, Cliff has grace and style. For the longest time, Cliff carried Hamlet in his back pocket. You will never know what that meant to me, Cliff. You loved Hamlet. You read it. You read the scenes before we read them in class. You added comments to the class discussion that I had never heard of before this year, and I have been teaching this play since it was first published. You are a brave, courageous, smart, lovable, scary mountain of a man. We are so proud of you. Good luck next year at College of the Canyons.
Is truly an outlier, a black swan, that thing you don't see coming, but then it arrives in a manner you couldn't have imagined. There is no way to clearly define Aaron by conventional standards. He's a Project Runway fan, along with being a Simpsons fan. He's got high tastes, but managed to eat a lollipop that was in Minnie's car for 2 years. He possesses a serious demeanor, but when he laughs, he lets it roar. His laugh is undeniably his. He's very independent, but occasionally gives bear hugs that knock people off their feet. He can't spell to save his life, but he's a great writer. He's a black diamond skier, but stayed on the green slopes all day in Canada to help Alex Beasy stay alive. Truly, even the teachers didn't have what it took to get Alexander down that mountain in Canada. Beasy probably owes her life to Aaron Mather. Trying to help Alexandra ski was reportedly like herding cats. There were screams and limbs flying and all manner of falling, skidding, slipping, and mayhem on the snowy slopes with her. Miss Rhody would close her eyes and pray passionately every time Beasy got going after a chaotic fall, or when Beasy was just frozen and a would-be skier stands in the middle of the mountain with expert skiers whizzing by taunting her. Only Aaron had the skill, the patience, and the bravery to get that woman down that mountain. Aaron has always done what was necessary to challenge himself. He reads all his books on tape. He took a college math class too to prepare himself for next year. We are proud of how far you've come during your time at Westmark. Good luck at American University next year.
Max Mason. do it. Max Mason, are you standing close so you can hit me? Okay. Max Mason is the poster child for the front row four. Notoriously late, often wielding nothing but a cup of coffee when he arrives, he has evolved a skill that will serve his business and political acumen in the future, but does little for his hyper-wise teachers. Max arrives late, bearing gifts. A tardy Max will often bring us a piping hot cup of coffee. Max doesn't realize that we are wary of students who come bearing gifts, especially those that are consumable and might be tainted. Not to mention the fact that Karen doesn't drink coffee, but okay. Yeah, it's okay. Then I am double and I'm shaking. Student gifts come at a great price. They usually mean we have to forgive some egregious academic sin, like missing a test, or not having homework, or not even being cognizant that you're entering an English class and should be in possession of a book. Max's stunning inability to think beyond the moment is probably because he has morphed into his dog. Apparently, he looks just like his best friend, Scooby. Like Scooby, Max is manhandled affectionately by all his other classmates. And like Scooby, who probably brings Max the occasional mouse carcass or dead bird, Max brings us coffee and places it on our desk with a "look what I did for you, there's no way you can be mad at me" facial expression. Scooby is probably a show dog with papers that give him a certain cachet in the world, just like Max. In Canada, Max didn't go skiing or ice skating because he's a prized athlete and the safety of his person is of the utmost importance. He really, really is an amazing athlete. Also, just like a dog, Max did his research project on the art of picking up a woman. Well, okay, it's really more about mating rituals, but you get my point. And finally, because this metaphor is just too fun to let go, Max has a team of people who scoop up after him. Just the other day, the entire maintenance crew was scouring the campus looking for his misplaced backpack. We organize him, help him with his homework, make appointments for him, walk him to class, create schedules, do any manner of service for him because, and here's the real truth of it all, we love him. Like a furry, loving, panting, loyal puppy, we love Max. We all do. And Max, dogs have keen insight. They're strong and courageous, and they serve those they love above all else. I'm horribly afraid of them, but they really do have good qualities, and I'm not afraid of you. Okay. They hang in there, and they love unconditionally, just like you. While it may seem as if you've been living a dog's life, you have so much more than that. Be courageous. Sometimes your parents should put you on a leash, though. Good luck next year at College of the Canyons. We know you'll do great. Yeah.
Although Tessa is not part of the notorious front row four, she is nonetheless always late. Tessa is always late to first period, or on Thursdays in second period when I have her. Always. "Tessa," the teacher yells, "you're late again." And then she smiles a big smile like she always does, not to apologize or sweet face us or suck up in any way. She just smiles as if to say, "I know, I'm here now and it's all just fine. You and your neurotic obsession with punctuality cannot faze my genuine eternal joy." And once she arrives, it really is all just fine. I'm sure she's late, because according to the other kids, Tessa lives up a windy, scary, wooded road. The kind that is described in every creepy horror story or Legend of Sleepy Hollow-esque tale. I'm sure leaving her house in the morning is an act of courage, so I forgive you. But because you're late every day, you miss the formal tea service, replete with scones and mimosas that are served before you arrive. Oh well, you snooze, you lose. On the very positive side of things, Tessa holds down a special sanity frequency. We've never seen her angry or sad or unhinged. Every single one of these kids sees us like that every week. I'm sure Tessa has a vast array of effects and emotions, but the one she brings to school every day is joy. There's not a person in this class who would say one negative thing about Tessa. Indeed, there are none to be told. That is quite an accomplishment. You've managed to get through 4 years of high school with everyone loving everything about you. Bless you, woman. You may have taught us more than we could ever have taught you. Good luck next year at Pierce. We know you'll do well.
In the year of Barack Obama, hope has come to mean many things. And Hope McLeod herself represents all these things. So it is appropriate that she was at the National Convention when a new symbol of hope was chosen for our country. I'm so jealous of that. Hope's name was aptly chosen. It's no mistake that this woman is moved to let a karate chop fly every once in a while. She has the spirit of a ninja. So occasionally she'll hit herself in the face while going for a volleyball, but every ninja must feel some pain along the way to hone her obvious skill and power. Hope is always filled with hope. About family, about school, about her future, about all things that matter. Hope springs eternal in hope, and that's why she joined in all the winter activities in Canada, even though skiing was one of her biggest fears. I hope inner tubing down snowy mountains didn't get added to that list, but come on, watching Cliff fall was worth it, wasn't it? Thanks, Cliff. Her use of pink pens to complete her homework is more proof of her constant hope. Daily homework, that gray, mundane, often mind-numbing experience, becomes a work of art in Hope's hands. It says, "My work makes me happy. I give you all the energy and care I can possibly put on this page. I stand out. I'm unique. I have hope that you will like it. And hope I always do. You try so hard, you put forth all you have to give, and those are the greatest signs of hope." I saw a bumper sticker during the campaign that said, "Hope is the new black." Indeed, hope is everywhere these days. It's even in pink pens. But most clearly, it was in my second period. Good luck next year at Marymount.
Joshua Sackheim. Josh is the fourth member of the front row four. Usually when all four of the front row four are missing from first period and the rest of the class is taking bets as to who will arrive first, Josh is the clear winner. Everyone assumes he will arrive first because, well, look at him. There is such an inherent quality of goodness in him, such an air of integrity and genuineness, a modern-day Ron Howard, if you will. How can you think a man of this sort would be too late for school? His pure spirit surely couldn't allow it, and his obvious crush on Miss Zaragoza can't keep him away from school for long. But don't let his surface Richie Cunningham OP persona fool you. Josh Sackheim is pure evil. Josh spends an inordinate amount of time making paper airplanes in class, or at least he did for a while. Funny how he can organize a single piece of paper into an airplane, but can't organize the papers in his notebook to save his life. Josh is usually late to school because he's sitting at home poking voodoo dolls of George Bush, Rush Limbaugh, and Dick Cheney with sharp needles and chanting ritualistic curses at them. On certain days, he misses first period altogether because he brings his life-size mannequin of Jane Schaefer out of the closet, ties her to a chair, tapes her mouth shut, and with the whip in hand, upbraids her for all she has done to destroy the education and learning potential of boys and girls across this country. This is important work Josh is doing, and sometimes he just needs to be late. Jane Schaefer must be stopped. Josh is a brilliant comedian and creative mind. He's an activist and a humanitarian. He's been an enthusiastic and caring class president, and WNN won't be the same without his presence on the news. We wish him the best of luck at Emerson next year.
Nick has unlimited text messages as part of his phone service. Otherwise, his parents will have to use his college fund to pay the bill. Women send Nick more text messages a day than Ashton Kutcher got people to follow him on Twitter. No wonder Nick is often exhausted. Keeping up with a million text messages a day takes effort. It can leave Nikki cranky and weary and indignant over dress code. For more than a year, Nick wore a tie over every manner of shirt, even a t-shirt. The ties clashed wildly with his multicolored headphones that he wore like most people wear glasses. It was as if his ears needed those headphones to hear. When asked to remove them in class, he reacted as if we were calling for an amputation. He wore them so often that perhaps his head actually started to grow around them and it was painful to get them off. One thing you truly should have surgically implanted in you is a caffeine drip. Perhaps then you'd be able to wake yourself up in the morning and get yourself to any classes you have. Nick isn't very subtle about anything. When he's having a bad day or a good day, you know it. Nick, you're just like me in this. And that got me thinking. I've often looked at you, your hair color, your eye color, your skin tone, your emotional meltdowns, your adoration of Eddie Izzard, that's fun, and the real similarity, your love of Hamlet, and I wondered, wait a minute, did I have a kid out of college that I don't remember? It was the 90s, I mean, it wasn't the 60s, I think I knew what was going on, but if I did, and if that kid were you, I'd be pretty darn proud. You're an awesome and talented human being, even if you're colorblind. Nick, your car is orange. I just thought someone should tell you before you go to Oregon and people think you're some freaky artist from California. Oh, wait, you are, and you're perfect like that. You've been a wonderful vice president and filmmaker this year. Good luck next year. We will miss your colorful self.
Grayson Steckling. Grayson Steckling is a walking anachronism. One part of him is from the 1920s. I'm pretty sure that he's playing baseball for the fictitious Black Stockings. He must be. I can see no other reason for why he wore black knee-high stockings and a baseball cap to school for a while. Another part of him embodies that 1950s portrait of a rascal Dennis the Menace. I mean, really, Grayson kind of looks like him, and all the trouble Grayson finds himself in is always unintentional and in the spirit of fun. All his teachers are just like hapless Mr. Wilsons, looking for a serene and quiet life. That Dennis Grayson just keeps disrupting, albeit apologetically. Oh, geez, Mr. Wilson, I didn't realize you were standing there when my slingshot went off. Or, I didn't mean to drink the gallon-sized container of vitamins and minerals and act like a zombie and scare you out of your wits, Miss Rhodey. Or, really, my music was playing so loud you couldn't hear yourself think? Gee, sorry, Mr. Sanders. There's another part of Grayson that represents yet another part of the 1950s culture. When he was hanging out with Jake, you couldn't help but wonder if those two weren't the reincarnation of some nonconformist beat poets. They had all the spontaneous creativity and new kind of bohemian hedonism with all the accoutrements that money can buy, of course, cool haircuts, iPods, Blackberries, cars. But beside that, they got the beat thing covered. If the two of them decided to take it on the road, I might get just a bit worried. Grayson does appear to be an amalgam of qualities from decades gone by, and this might account for his wistful stares and his desire to sit way off in the corner away from it all. But look, Grayson, every really cool person didn't think they fit into their world. The world gets changed by people like you who find certain things about the present world annoying. All your sensitivity, artistry, and style will bring about something new and needed beyond the return of knee socks. You've been kind and organized, and you liked to learn. We appreciated all the uniqueness you brought with you to school every day. Good luck next year.
On school trips, Robin freaks out her roommates because she sleep talks, sleep walks, and sleep gets dressed. In class, however, she is no such somnambulist. She is alive and bristling, ready to tell us what needs to be done and how to get it done. She walks characteristically on her toes as if she's about to take flight. And since Robin takes lots and lots of vitamins, perhaps she might. Robin cares deeply about individual and social justice. I've seen this personally. One day, I asked her to take out a piece of paper, and while she was doing that, her notebook broke. "Look what you made me do, Miss Rhodey," she said. I promptly took responsibility for my actions, and I learned my lesson well. Kidding aside, Robin is a sensitive, supremely creative soul. She's an extraordinary artist, and she downplays her ability in this area. Her artwork is stunning. You really do have a gift, and I'm sure you will use it to make life more beautiful for all of us. I will always remember you as my brave skiing partner in Canada. Robin and I were partnered up in a ski lesson together, and she was forever saying things like, "Good job, Miss Rhodey, way to go," even though I looked like a huge dork who needed all kinds of guidance while three-year-olds in $1,000 snowsuits whizzed past me on the bunny slope. Robin didn't see any of that. She just saw an old woman who needed some encouragement, and she gave it. She moved on to ski a million miles an hour down the big hills to the amazement of the rest of the class, yes. That was your reward for your generous spirit. You have an exciting life ahead of you. Good luck next year.
For Maddie, school is the fly in the ointment of her social life. First through sixth periods really get in the way of a life well lived on Facebook. But thank God she's got a BlackBerry she uses during every period and a fashion sense that broadcasts her path in life. These things get her through the day. Maddie is a fashion goddess. She maneuvers the fashion websites like a seasoned race car driver in the Indy 500. For Maddie, there's nothing so awful that a pair of new shoes and a new top that covers her neck bruises can't cure. And this wild woman needs these purchases. She does. How else can she host parties at her house where hundreds of people show up? She must look her best. Now, her notebook and her purse are another matter. Maddie's purse and notebook belie her well-coiffed self. They are shredded from use and abuse. They are literally shredded. Erin and Jordan sat in class one day under a crazy OCD spell and ripped the pleather off her purse with Howard Hughes-level fanaticism and devotion. What is it about Maddie that makes men want to get their hands on her accessories and obsess on them in class? What kind of power does this woman possess? Clearly, Maddie is a Hollywood madam, the Heidi Fleiss of the 21st century. The big parties, the chic attire, the hiding out in the back row of class, the quiet response from her classmates when asked to disclose details about Maddie all indicate that she runs a clandestine social escort service of sorts. No wonder this woman is so popular. It can't just be her bubbly personality and charm. I'm sure this secret business all started after she began stalking her neighbor, who is apparently quite cute, but not the relationship type. She had to funnel her passion somewhere. Next year, I'm sure all her passion will go into fashion school, where her obvious talents will be put to good use. Maddie, in all seriousness, you figured out the business of school this year. You were more focused this year and completed more work than you have in the past. You're smart, capable, and creative, and we're very proud of you. Good luck and have fun at FITM next year. You are a talented, sensitive being, and we all appreciated you.
The beat-up hat, the sunglasses, the head down, the quiet affect, all say, "Go away and leave me alone." But his work, his writing, his music, his answers in class, his hickeys, all say, "Hey, look at me." He said something about Coachella and Chick Magnet. I don't know. I didn't understand, but I'm sure it was an interesting time, as you are indeed an interesting man. Ben is Westmark's traveling minstrel. His guitar, mandolin, and accordion go with him everywhere throughout the day. I've always had this fantasy of having a soundtrack to my life play throughout the day for everyone to hear and know how I'm feeling without having to say it. Like I walk into first period and the class would hear, wah, wah, in sad, dark tones. Just kidding, first period. And then the nutrition bell would ring and fireworks would explode. By lunch, the chorus to Bon Jovi's Living on a Prayer would play. I really, really believe that Ben would be a great person to make this level of fantasy happen for someone. He could follow a person around with his guitar and other instruments and melody up his or her life, create a soundtrack, if you will. He's insightful and knowing. Everyone wants to feel like a star of their own sitcom, and Ben has the power to make someone feel that way. I'll pay you to do this if things don't work out in Europe, so just let me know. I am convinced that Ben, his soul, is what kept the senior class operational, well, at least semi-operational on a daily basis. Some silent, powerful part of you kept us as level-headed as we could possibly be. You kept us from yelling at each other, from hitting each other, well, at least from hitting Brian Mandel. Pulling out hair, running, screaming from weekly madness, you were just that powerful. All your teachers reveled in the miracle that was your transformation from junior year to senior year. You earned straight A's your first semester, and that was a dream last year. This year, you embodied the idea that a human being can indeed make the impossible possible. I hope we all take that lesson and allow it to work in our own lives, and when we see it occur, we will call it the Ben Sperling phenomenon. Good luck in your travels around Europe and whichever course of study you choose to pursue. You're a talented man.
When I get older, I will be stronger. They'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag.
When I get older, I will be stronger. They'll call me freedom, just like a waving flag. And then it goes back, and then it goes back, and then it goes back. Oh.
Born to a throne, stronger than Rome, but violent prone, poor people's zone. But it's my home, all I have known, where I got grown, streets we would roam. Out of the darkness, I came the farthest, among the hardest survivors. Learn from these streets, it can be bleak, accept no defeat, surrender, retreat.
So we struggle there.